Hey everybody, it's George the Tech, and I have a very special presentation tonight because I don't do a lot of product reviews because it's so time consuming to do it right, but it's a lot more fun and I'm a lot more motivated to do it when I get to do it with two friends and really respected folks in our midst of the voiceover world. And so tonight I've got down below, but I don't even know where you'll be in the final edit because I'm going to cut this letter together later. But I've got with me, first of all, Andrew Peters, who is our one of our lovely co-hosts from the Pro Audio Suite from Down Under. How you doing, Andrew?
I'm doing very well, George, and it's kind of weird being on camera together. Normally we're just coming in through the headphones and doing weird finger clicks, but it's nice to be here.
It is. This is our second on-camera review of a product, ironically, or coincidentally would be the proper way of saying it, for the Austrian Audio OC818 microphone. Yep. So this has just seemed fitting. And also joining me, because we found out he also has a pair of these amazing Austrian Audio headphones and loves them and had some things to say, our good friend Paul Strikwerda. How you doing, Paul?
I'm doing great. Back here in Pennsylvania, we just had a fresh coat of snow. I'm going to put on my snowshoes tonight. I'm going to walk around the neighborhood and then take it all in. The little bit of winter that's left, it's wonderful.
I'll live vicariously through you, having grown up in that region and missing
it a little bit. Yes, Westchester, right?
Westchester, that's right.
Home of QVC.
Home of QVC, that's, and Bam Margera of Jackass. Those are what we know, our two main claims to fame.
And George Widom.
And George the
Congratulations, by the way, on your 200th episode of the VOBS show.
That's right. We just did our 200th. Thank you.
amazing.
Yeah, plus the EWABs before it, you know, which was another 5 years worth of boring content. No, it's a lot of stuff. anyway, we go on, but this is the way we do things. We're here to talk about these headphones right here, the Austrian Audio Hi-X55s. So, gentlemen, I've already worn them for a little while and had a little bit of time with them, not hours and days, but several hours, and so enough time to hear them. You guys are both wearing them right now. I just thought I would take them out of the box and just do a really basic unboxing. So sometimes when you get stuff sent to you, and full disclosure, I received this from Austrian Audio for a review. Paul, did you also receive one as a review model?
They sent them to me on permanent loan.
Because
here's what happened. I first reviewed the OC18 microphone, which is the brother of the OC818. They liked my review that much. They said, "We've got something new. Would you like to review that too?" I said, "Well, if it's as good as the OC18, please send it to me." That's what they did. And then I never expect people to send me stuff because I don't want to give people the impression that they pay me through the equipment.
Right.
But they said, you can keep it. It's on permanent loan. So I've been wearing these for about a year now. I think I was one of the first to receive it.
Oh, wow. That's a long-term review. So I'm glad that you're here because you're coming at this from someone that's got a lot of time with these headphones.
Oh, yes. I spent most of my days with them on my face. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, fortunately, these are nice to have on your face because they have massive ear cups.
Yes. It's all memory foam, too.
See how deep they are? That's the big thing, the depth of the cup.
As you can tell, I got huge ears, and I always have trouble. I'm not going to lie about it. I've got a big noggin and huge ears, and I have trouble finding the right headphones. And I started with the AKG 240Ks, which are nice and light, but semi-open, wonderful. But they were not big enough for my ears. And they say that the older you get, everything starts shrinking, but your nose and your ears. So I really needed to find headphones that would accommodate my huge ears, and these do it. They're like discs, these ears, I can tune into Mars if I try hard enough.
How about you?
Could be handy.
How's the fit for you?
I really like them, but I will show you these. Talking about headphones that fit, these are the my AKG K601s, but they are open back. They're really nice, very comfortable.
Those are hi-fi headphones, right?
Well, they're
quote-unquote.
Well, yeah, kind of. I think, most headphones really, I guess, are hi-fi.
I say that because they're marketed sometimes differently. Some headphones are marketed to the pro audio world and EQ'd for pro audio, and these definitely are pro audio headphones, and I'll talk about why I say that. But
absolutely,
yeah. And then there's other headphones, and they can be in the same price point. I mean, it used to be that only audiophiles would pay $300+ for headphones. Now, Beats and many other consumer headphones are well over $300. So that's history. But I don't remember my point. But the point I guess I was making is these are pro headphones, and some others are really more for enjoyment of music.
And I think I think the other thing is a lot of headphones are fashion. That's it. You know,
yeah.
So you're buying. It's like getting whatever. It's the fashion of the day. Where these are a workhorse, and I think that's why some people, when they put them on initially, get a shock. I mean, I certainly did. I didn't expect to hear what I was going to hear, and I think Paul's probably going to say the same, and maybe you will too. But then you start to realize how accurate they are when you play something that's a reference, like you drag out some music that you know really well, which I saw you did on Instagram yesterday.
Yeah, George. I did a little teaser unboxing thing, and I had a little talk about the headphones. And yeah, I mean, what music do you guys like to listen to? I'm assuming you like to listen to some music when you get a new pair of headphones or speakers. Paul, what do you like to listen
to? Well, you know, I reviewed these on my blog. So if you go to nethervoice.com and type in Austrian audio, you'll get the review. And I have special tracks that are used to test audio. And some of them are binaural recordings.
Ooh, yeah,
you that's know, they, cool. They have microphones inside one of those mannequin heads,
right.
You know?
Yeah.
And then they walk through the streets of New York. And I discovered them because I had trouble falling asleep. And I found on YouTube there's a whole line of binaural audio. But it's really, I call it like 3D sound. So if you really want to test your audio, your headphones, go for binaural. And there's also a guy called Darren Fu who has recorded different sounds as heard through different speakers. And when you go to his website, Darren Fu, you can download that.
Is it F-O-O?
F-O-O, yes, yes.
Thank you.
And I use that too because it's really gives you the feeling that you're inside of the sound. And you can click on different, let's say you want to hear genelic speakers, you click on that, you hear the sound as if it were sampled through genelic.
Ah.
It's like a simulator like they have for different microphones. You click on
simulated
something,
control
I want to hear 87. Yeah, exactly. So I use that and a couple of other tests.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm a big fan of classical music and jazz music as well. So one of the things that I like to do is the Organ Symphony by Saint-Saëns. We really hear the full orchestra, the low, low pipes of the organ. And
you're going to get the full 20 to 20 experience, 20 hertz to 20K.
Yes,
for sure.
Yeah. And if I get goosebumps on my spine, then I know that what I'm wearing is great. Goosebumps from the spine is for me the sign that I'm wearing something incredible.
Yeah.
And with these headphones, you know, it's hard to explain because we're talking about it, but the people who are watching cannot hear them. But I thought about a way to describe it. And the other day I had to go to get new prescription for my glasses. And all of a sudden it dawned upon me, you know, all of us wear glasses. And, you know, let's say you're wearing your glasses for a year and you think they're still good. You know, they're fine. You can do with the glasses what you want to do. But then you go to the ophthalmologist and you get your eyes tested and they come up with a new prescription and they twist and tweak things. And all of a sudden, you look at that chart in front of you and you can see things that you never saw before. It all becomes clear and you did not know that beforehand that your hearing had deteriorated. Your eyesight has deteriorated. The same happened to me with these Austrian audios because I was listening to these babies, my Biodynamics DT880s,
and I'm currently wearing the 770s, just so you
know. Yeah, because they're closed. These are semi-open.
Right.
And I love these guys. I mean, they hug your ears
comfy.
Like little teddy bears.
Right.
Very comfy.
Yeah.
And I thought they were accurate and precise.
Sure.
But then I put on these Hi-X55s, and it was as if I was at the ophthalmologist. All of a sudden, I could hear things that I did not hear before.
Right.
And it was literally an eye-opening, an ear-opening experience.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Andrew, what did you listen to the first time you put on these headphones?
Well, before I say that, it was a good point about glasses because we all wear glasses.
Yeah.
And one of the most irritating things about wearing glasses is headphones because you break the seal.
True.
But these actually seem to work really well as far as the seal's concerned. Just thought I'd throw that in.
Yeah, that's soft, super compliant.
Yeah.
Deep pad means it will can form around an earpiece of your glasses well.
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
So for me, music, because I spent 20 years in radio from the late 70s through to the end of the 90s, I'm used to hearing certain songs. You know, if you worked in a rock format or a pop format, then you get to know songs. So I dig out The Cure. Mm-hmm. So I play some Cure because, you know, a lot of synth and stuff like that. Something from the 70s, like Tom Petty.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, the songs I used was Refugee, Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, Close to Me, The Cure, and then I played some Velvet Underground just to top it off. And,
yeah, Refugee is a very high fidelity song.
It is.
Organs, and it's high production value.
And the drum, you know, that drum, the opening, drum sequence, you know. So... And, you know, you sit here, I've listened to them for years and years and years, like 40 years or whatever.
Sure.
More. I just heard stuff in there that I'd never heard before.
Mm-hmm.
And it was bizarre. Like, there was something in The Cure. I think it was some hand claps that I'd never heard. I also heard the reverb that I'd never heard on the vocals.
That's a telltale sign of a good monitoring system when the reverb tail, which is how the reverb decays off into space. If you can really resolve and hear all that reverb, that's another sign of a good pair of headphones, for sure.
Yeah, and I certainly heard it clear as a bell. So that to me was like, wow. Because before I listened to music, I put them on, sat in the studio, and in fact, I did a playback of a voiceover I just cut.
Sure.
And I'm like, ooh, that doesn't sound good. That sounds terrible.
Well, this is the double-edged sword of good headphones, right?
Yeah,
you put
on
a really good, revealing, very brutally honest pair of headphones, and all of a sudden, things that you didn't know, maybe you wish you never heard in the first place, becomes
very
audible.
Well, it's like going to buy clothes. You know, right. you try on the shirt and ask the person who's selling it to you, what does it look like? They go, that looks fantastic. And then you get home, and your wife goes, oh, my God, that looks ridiculous. That's horrid.
So yeah, maybe the sales lady was a bit young and a bit attractive. That might have thrown you off the scent. So so for me, I did the same. You know, I put these on and listened to music that I was familiar with. I like to go to a new young artist named Jacob Collier because I've been obsessed with his music for a couple of years. So I've listened to the hell out of his music, and it's impeccably produced. And I happen to know he uses Grace mic preamps, and we love Grace, and you know, they're super hi-fi, and I just know everything he does is just absolutely impeccable. So I put his stuff on, and everything you guys said, I totally agree with. And I'm going to switch the headphone. I'm going to switch them out here. Here we go. Can I hear him? Yeah, I hear him. I'm using the Rodecaster Pro right now, by the way, which is kind of fun because it has four headphone jacks.
Yes.
And so I can quickly switch cans and I can level match them all so that they, when I switch, they're as close as I can get them as possible. And these are a lot more sensitive than my Beyers, which these are 80 ohm Beyers, mm-hmm. and my Audio Technica ATH M40X headphones. These are even more sensitive than these other cans. And it's interesting because traditionally, professional headphones are usually higher impedance. And these are only 25 ohms.
Yeah,
I'm not enough of an engineering equipment designer to understand everything that there is to know about why that's significant or not. But in practice, what that means is that you can plug these into really anything. Your MacBook, your phone, any mixer, any interface. Dare I say, I haven't tried it with a Scarlett yet, but it should have decent levels even with a Scarlett 2i2, which is notoriously not very high output. And that's going to help you. So that's kind of like a side effect or a nice side benefit that these headphones are so easy to drive. So you'll get the volume you're looking for. And this is one of the reasons why, and I don't want to offend anybody, but I think this is one of the reasons why these are great headphones for someone who has lost maybe portions or some of their hearing over the years. Okay? Andrew's raising his hand. I know from working with Andrew that some hearing loss is kind of part of the deal.
Yeah.
Hearing loss is part of the deal for anybody as they age. This is the human condition. Of course, hearing loss is also a part of hearing damage from being in bands and going to concerts and things like that. And this is why reviewing headphones is so difficult, because absolutely everybody is going to hear these headphones differently. No two people have the same hearing response. That's why hearing aids are so dang expensive, because you go in and they measure your hearing and they custom tune the hearing aid to match your hearing. And so every pair of headphones has its unique sound, and every pair of ears has its unique way of hearing. It's not like microphones where I can take the same mic. We could take the OC818, for example, and put it up in front of any one of us, and it's going to sound pretty damn good. But the same headphones on three different heads, we're all going to have different impressions of how they sound. So for me, these are a little bit too, what I would call, too forward. So for me, the mid-range is too pronounced. And it doesn't mean that they're not accurate, but I'm so used to using headphones that don't have that forward sound, that are maybe a little flatter or maybe have a little dip in the mid-range. And that would definitely be the Audio-Technicas and the Beyerdynamics, both of which the Beyers I've used for 20 years. So my hearing is tuned to that sound. I put these on, and all of a sudden, it's like I went to my stereo. Remember when they had tone controls, and the really good ones had a mid-range knob, not just treble and bass? For me, it's like I went up and I cranked up the mid-range knob 5 or 6 dB. And so it's a little too far forward. But I can see why that would be perfect for someone that is suffering some hearing loss in that frequency range. And that range that these headphones exaggerate, it's not even fair to say exaggerate, just kind of bring forward, that's going to complement somebody who may have lost some of their hearing in that range. It's very common to lose hearing between 1 and 4,000 hertz. That's one of the first areas. And that's that clarity of speech frequency range that's so critical. That's why hearing aids boost that frequency range so that people can now understand speech. And that's exactly why these headphones are so excellent at bringing out all that little details and articulation and human speech. And so for you guys and for many, many others, this is going to be huge. You are going to hear stuff that you've never heard before. And maybe for a few others that are like me, it could be a little too much of a good thing. So I could switch to these headphones, but I would have to take some time to reprogram my hearing and kind of what I call learn. I'd have to learn these headphones, because if I didn't do that, I might start making alterations to my EQ settings on people's audio that aren't what they should be. So that's my only knock against these headphones, is that they are different. It just doesn't make it bad. It's just they're different.
What I like about it is that they don't have this hyped bass, this boomy bass.
Right.
And that's a trend in headphones, you know, because a lot of people use them with their mobile devices.
That's what I mean by like consumer headphones versus professional.
Exactly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And these are not made to sound necessarily pleasant or good. They're made to reveal. They have to be merciless and unflattering. They're made to expose all the flaws instead of covering them up.
Mm-hmm.
And that's exactly what happened when I listened, because you said, what are we listening to test these headphones?
Right.
My ultimate test was my own voiceover recordings. I listened to the recordings that I already had edited, recorded years and years ago, on these Beyerdynamics. And by goodness, I listened and I heard things that I should have edited out. I heard the lip smacks.
Mm-hmm.
I heard my breathing. I heard rustling of my clothes. And all of a sudden, I looked in the mirror and I felt like I was naked. All my flaws were exposed. So I hated these for a while.
Yeah, right, right. Yeah.
But I thought, if I can hear them, certainly a client can hear them, or the studio engineer that they hired to process my audio.
The engineer will hear
So I thought all this time that I was giving them pristine audio. Well, I'm telling you, don't know what pristine is until you've listened to them through these headphones. And I'm not saying this because Austrian Audio was kind enough to give these to me. because I cannot be bought. I tell people, my voice is for hire, but my opinion is not for sale.
Right.
I would have done the same thing had I bought them myself.
Can I ask you this? Yeah. As someone that also reviewed the 818, or the, I'm sorry, the 18. You did you review both the 818 and the 18, or just the 18?
No, just the 18, yes. I had no need for the 818.
Was the...
too many bells and whistles.
Was that one a loaner, or was that a permanent loaner, or was that a, would you send it back soon?
Also a permanent loan, yes.
Very nice.
Yeah, I'm very lucky. I'm very lucky. Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's one of the benefits of having a blog with quite a few subscribers, I guess. Because
sure.
I was the first, I think, voiceover at least, the first one to receive the Austrian Audio microphone, because until then, nobody had heard about Austrian Audio. So I could tell their whole story. The same thing happened with the CAD 101 E100S
right.
as well. I think it was one of the first voiceovers, not to pat myself on the back, to write about that one. And that became kind of a nice classic microphone in the voiceover world, too.
Right.
And then I heard through the grapevine about Austrian Audio. I said, boy, even if what they make is crap, their story is so interesting.
Right.
Because you want to tell the story a little bit for those who are not familiar?
You know, I don't have enough detail to fill in the gaps. You guys can Google that. But what I understand is these folks are engineers that go back a pretty long way. You know, they were developing microphones for AKG, right?
Exactly.
And
the original, the AKG gang. And they.
And how far back do these guys go? I mean, this guy's got to be
in their
70s.
Yeah.
But I know that there's some people on their team that are still hand-assembling the C-12 capsules.
That's amazing.
Which they still use, but they've improved them over the years. But
that's
amazing. AKG got bought by Harman Kardon, and Harman Kardon got bought by Samsung.
Right.
And now AKG is more focusing on consumer electronics instead of the pro audio things.
Yep.
And basically, the old folks at AKG bought their own company, including the furniture and the anechoic chamber.
Yeah, they didn't just go start a company. They negotiated to buy all their equipment and the facilities, which was a brilliant move because, I mean,
absolutely.
That was brilliant. And props to Samsung, who said yes. You know, I got to give them huge props for that, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But it's interesting because they were working on the new C12, the C12 capsule. That's what they were doing R&D at AKG. So all that R&G that had been put in with AKG, they took to Austrian Audio, and that became the capsule that's in the OC818 and OC18.
Absolutely.
And it's funny because I've got an old C414EB.
Mm-hmm.
Which
we love.
Which everyone sort of poo-poos the nylon version of the C12 capsule.
Nice.
But it actually sounds really good.
Yeah.
But it's interesting that they're so close.
Mm-hmm.
It is so close.
Mm-hmm.
It's beautiful.
It is beautiful. Yeah. So, I mean, the bottom line is we could ramble on about these, but it's kind of like describing a painting. You would really have to hear them for yourself. But if you've got headphones that are getting worn out, long in the tooth, I've heard this actually in the conversation, in these comments about, you know, having posted that video, some people were like, well, I was using XYZ headphone and they wore out. And then I bought a new pair and they didn't sound anything like my old ones.
Yeah.
Right. And this is not uncommon. As headphones age, the drivers get broken in and they kind of wear, and like the ear pads get worn out, and the sound of headphones change over the years. And so when you get a brand new pair, not only is there a difference in because they're brand new, sometimes the headphone maybe changes a little bit in its manufacturing. So things change. So it might be a time to try out a new pair of headphones. So if you've been thinking about spending up, maybe going from where you are now, I would think these would be an awesome cross or upgrade, not cross grade really, but an upgrade for people using the Sonys that are so pervasive, the MDR-7506. They're also a very forward headphone, but in a different way. They have a really bright, bright upper top end, like that sibilant range. And so if that's kind of making you a little crazy and you want something a little bit, still has that honesty, but is a little bit more honest and accurate, then these might be a really nice place to go.
It's interesting you talk about the mids being forward.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if it's because they've sculpted out some of the low.
Yeah.
It makes you think it's forward, but it's not fighting with the bottom end so much. Maybe that's it. I don't know.
Well, you know, it's weird. If you've ever geeked out on headphones, and this is what happens to me. I watch some reviews, then I start going down the rat hole, and I start looking at high fidelity sites, you know, headphone review websites where these guys, I looked on this one, they said, here's our top 20 headphones. I heard of precisely three of them, right?
Yeah.
There's like all these companies I've never even heard of, right? And there's like a $6,000 headphone. So I went down that rat hole, and some of them will have, you know, the frequency responsive headphones. If you start looking at the frequency responsive headphones, the curve is really weird. Like, you'll look at a microphone, and it might have a relatively flat low end, and it might have a little rise at the top or maybe a little bump here and there. But a headphone response is very different. It'll be like this and then another thing, and then at the top, it'll have like a big spike, and then it's very strange. And so when I looked at the curve of these and then looked at the curve of my Audio Technicas, they were rather different. So yeah, they accentuate different frequencies from each other, and that's why they're different.
It's like tuning an instrument. You know, my wife is a professional piano player and flutist, and she knows that when she gets a different technician, her grand piano, her Steinway, gets tuned differently, brings out the highs, brings out the lows, makes it more mellow. But most of these headphones that are being reviewed are evaluated for the way they faithfully reproduce sound, and they flatter the sound. You know, the more flattering they are, the higher up in the ranks they end up in the reviews.
It's subjective,
these
folks.
These are really not made to flatter the sound. They are really unflattering.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. That's really what makes these pro monitoring headphones and not quote unquote hi-fi or audiophile headphones, I think.
Exactly. I mean, when I listen to my audio, first of all, I mix and master them with these cans. Mm-hmm. And then I listen to them on my PreSonus RS5 speakers.
Those are nice, yeah.
And then I go to my iMac as well, listen to my iMac speakers. Mm-hmm. And if all of that is pleasant, then I'm happy about it. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, listening in itself is also subjective. You know, like as you said, all our hearing is different, but listening is in fact interpreting.
Yes.
And we tend to like what we're used to. It's with people. People like things that are more like themselves and that are sounding familiar.
Right.
So I have to warn people who just spend $350 on these headphones, you're not going to like them.
You may not.
You're not going to like them.
You may not. They're going to be different from many. Again, they are quite different from the two pairs that I use day in, day out. So for me, that would be an adjustment period to use these as my daily drivers.
Yeah, but they are going to be super comfortable. As we already discussed, my voluminous head. I mean, I have trouble because I use the Sennheiser 280s that so many people are raving about, and they had this pressure on my noggin. Oh my gosh.
They're like a vice grip. Oh, I don't even have a big head. I have a relatively medium to small head, and they were too tight on my head. So
yeah, exactly. Yeah, the only thing I have to ding Austrian Audio on is that it's not this velvety plush cup that they have that our biodynamics are known for. I get a little bit sweaty. My ears get a little bit sweaty after a while, but I can take that because the good outweighs the bad by far.
I found replacement ear pads for my Audio Technicas that have that velvety thing.
Yes.
And they're super thick. Like they're even thicker than stock. Oh. And
That's the best.
I'm kind of spoiled.
Austrian Audio, if you're listening, please bring some velvet ear cups that would make it even better.
Here's a crazy hack. Yeah. What if you got some of that moleskin stuff and just lined it on the pad and just create like a velvet layer against your skin? Would that be a bad idea?
Lovely.
I don't know if I could do that on $350 headphones. If I could get another pair, if I get another replacement set of ear pads I could play around with, maybe I would do that.
Yeah. Because they're not round, right? They're kind of more oval.
No, they have a very, the shape is unique. They didn't make them on the most conventional shapes. They have a bit of their own unique shape, I think.
Yeah.
But anyway, yes, I'm very grateful to try new headphones. I'm a headphone addict. I love headphones. These are like shoes. So this is like getting sent a pair of, you know, Manola Blahniks.
Yeah.
Getting
nice.
A strut around in those. Not that I've ever done that.
When I was A-B-ing these headphones with the other ones I've got lying around here, the closest I got to this sound was the Audio Technica E50 in-ears.
Ooh, E50.
And
okay.
And I don't know why. I'm trying to work out why. I think it could be isolation or something. Look, I don't know why they were similar, but there was lots of similarity between, because they're not very forgiving either. I mean, they would tell you.
I have some weird off-brand Chinese Amazon Find 6 driver in-ears.
Yep.
6 drivers per ear. Yep. And they are brutal. I mean, they take what this does and takes it to another notch of like absolute mid-range clarity. And they're brutal. I mean, they reveal all. I couldn't listen to them for very long because my ears are just so sensitive in that like 2 to 4K frequency range. And most stuff bugs me. Everything to me sounds kind of harsh, or I'll use that ice pick in the forehead kind of analogy. That's just for me a frequency range that's tough for me. So if I had a way to custom EQ the headphones, I might use them even a little bit more. But bottom line is,
the sensitivity is a curse, you know. It's a professional deformation. Mm-hmm. It's like my friends who all went to conservatory and I take them to a concert of a symphony orchestra. I sit back, relax, and enjoy the music. But all they do is criticize and they hear what's wrong.
Yeah.
Whereas I take it in and hear everything that's right. You know?
It is a curse. I mean, if you're an audio engineer, going to live concerts is often, well, it used to be torture. It's gotten way better the last 10 years with computer-aided tuning, and there's a lot of things that have made it better. But anyway, we're really going off the tangent. But
but sort of. Sorry, George. I think I'd be curious to see what these are like on the road. The reason I got in-ears in the first place was, one, when we do our podcast, because my cans are bleeding because I've got them so loud.
Sure.
So in-ears stop that. But they also, when you're working remotely, you wear in-ears and you actually do hear, because there's no leakage, so you're actually hearing what's going into the microphone.
Right.
And I've got a feeling these, because of the cup design, these are going to be pretty damn close.
Yeah.
In that respect, they seem to block out quite a lot of external noise.
Yeah.
Actually coming in.
They don't fold up real tiny, but they do. Well, they do that. They do fold up like that. So that does make them pretty travel friendly. You know, they don't get super tiny, but at least you can get that slip into your computer bag kind of thing, and not that, you know, these things are ridiculous to travel with.
Yeah.
They're just gigantic.
Well, the trouble is you get to wherever you're going, you plug in your headphones, you realize one ear's gone because you snapped a wire. Yeah.
These things can take a hit, you know.
Yeah.
I dropped them a couple of times, I'll be honest, and they're still as good as new.
Yeah, no,
these are very well built, very sturdy, and at the same time, very lightweight. I don't know how these guys do it, but there's something in Austria, because Lewitt, talking about microphones, is also an Austrian company. They make outstanding microphones and now Austrian Audio as well. So the Austrians are onto something.
Yes, they are. Yeah. Well, this has been a lot of fun. I don't know if you guys have any other final words, but I think we've pretty much covered it. What you can cover with a pair of headphones,
I just think I think the key thing for these is it actually probably for me anyway, it just saves time because you actually know what you've recorded. You're not sort of sitting there trying to work out if there was something wrong. You kind of get it first hit, so you can keep moving forward.
And these are removable. Yes, these pads really are designed around the idea of replacement. You know, it's like they're admitting, yes, you will wear these out, and you will need to replace them. They come off something like that.
Not like that.
They just click on. They have little plastic tabs that the pad engages with. So they know that this is a wear item. And also, my understanding is that this is replaceable.
Hey, cool.
Oh, wow.
Okay. So nice. Now that I've completely removed my headphones and destroyed them. I like that they design these knowing that these things are going to wear out. They know they're not going to last forever. These are wear items. So this is replaceable and this is replaceable. And I think that's forward thinking.
Yeah,
absolutely. Which I think is very good for the environment as well. Because we live in a society where we use something up for a couple of years, then we throw it away and then we buy something brand new.
Yep.
Here you just keep the frame and replace a couple of parts, and it's good to go for many years.
Yeah, yeah.
What I like about them is that I know that I can deliver a better product because of these, because I can hear every little thing that I want to edit out before I send it to the client. And I know that I'm going to send a pristine audio, and whatever it is that I do, they might not like my voiceover performance, but they cannot fault me for my recording quality. And that's in part thanks to these guys.
That's what I tell my clients who hire me for tech help. By the way, you can do that at georgethe.tech. I tell it all the time. It's like you, the worst thing to do is to lose a gig because of the sound quality. You know, it's just because it's the one thing that you is fixable. I mean, yes, your acting is fixable. You can train and coach and on, but if you're not the guy for the part, you're not the guy for the part. But if you lost it because of sound quality, that's just a heartbreaker. That's just the worst thing ever. So.
Yeah,
right, because you have people who are phenomenal actors, but they have terrible sound quality. So you're not going to hire that guy, even though he could do Shakespeare like Sir Laurence Olivier.
And vice versa. I've heard some guys that have invested many hours, if not years, into their studios, and they can't act their way out of a paper bag.
Hopefully that. Hopefully that's not either Paul or I.
I am not dropping any hints, gentlemen. Not at all. But I mean, I hear it all the time. Well, I'm an IT guy. Well, okay. You're working with any coaches? Anyway, this has been fun. Thanks for your time, you guys. I'm glad we got to do this together. And maybe we'll find another product that lands in all of our laps somehow. And we'll get to... By the way, this is not related to our product, but what is that on your stand that you're just fondling? That looks like a violet.
This thing here, this is my latest baby. It's a Jay-Z Amethyst.
Oh, it's Jay-Z.
Jay-Z is a Latvian company. Janis Zurins.
I've met that guy a bunch of times.
Designed for Blue, right? And then he had a conflict with Blue, and then he started his own company. But, you know, I had a very good year last year, and I think that you need to reward yourself. And this is, when it came up last year, it was half off. Usually this is $1,200, and now about $600. Yeah. And has this nice vintage sound. So I'm going to review this soon in my blog, and I absolutely am in love with this.
So it's a smoother, when I think vintage, I think not overly bright or hyped. It's a smoother, flatter sound. Before we go, should we all plug ourselves real quick where you can find us around the interwebs? I'll start with you, Paul.
Nethervoice.com. Nether as in Netherlands, voice as in voice, make it into one word. Nethervoice.com. Every week a new blog.
Andrew?
Lovely. AndrewPetersVO.com is my website, or you can find me in Australia through Scout Management, or in the States through Stuart Talent New York.
And you can also find him on a podcast with me at theproaudiosuite.com. That's SUITE. And I'm George the Dot Tech. My name is my address. Thanks.